The summer of 2018 will forever be known as the summer of LeBron James. It is clear to everyone that this is what this offseason is going to be about. No player in history has ever changed the landscape of the NBA so much with a stroke of a pen, and he's done it not once, not twice, but now will be the third time in the last decade. But before we go on, congratulations to the Golden State Warriors for the third championship in 4 years and officially being classified in many's eyes as an NBA dynasty. Also, congratulations to Kevin Durant for his second finals MVP. I personally think it should have went to Steph, but I fully understand the reasoning for KD, and he is a deserving recipient. And before we get into this free agency decision, congratulations to LeBron James, first of all, for this amazing playoff run. Now, it did end in the sweep in the finals, but it will go down in history as one of the best carry jobs the league has ever seen, alongside the likes of Allen Iverson and Hakeem Olajuwon. Also, quick plug to the Dish podcast. We're going to go live tomorrow and every Sunday at 8 p.m. Eastern. And for the people asking about it on iTunes, we are literally like 90% of the way there. We're just waiting on our friends at Podbean to finish the setup process, and we should be all set to go from here on out. Anyways, this summer for LeBron is one of the most important summers of his career. Being 33 years old, still in his prime, being a perennial MVP candidate, and worthy of the biggest contract in the league, LeBron still has a lot to give to this game, and he knows it. LeBron knows about the GOAT conversation. LeBron knows that he's in it. LeBron knows that he still has enough in the tank to make the gap closer to many people, if not exceed it. To some, he already has. The question is, where will he go in order to fulfill this goal? There are a plethora of teams that have been rumored, and I will lay out the ones that I think LeBron should and will consider this offseason, their pros and their cons, which one I think LeBron should go to, and where I think he'll inevitably go to when it's all said and done. First, let's start with the hometown, the Cleveland Cavaliers. Look, I'm gonna keep it a bug, man. I don't think he's staying here. The upper management is one of the most incompetent group of people in the league, making bad trades, giving out bad contracts, and even if you want to blame LeBron for pressuring them to make those moves, they were the ones that folded into his request, and even Kyrie's request last offseason when they didn't really have to. And even if they were a competent group, aside from the Nets pick, I don't see any realistic move that will put them even close to being on par with the Warriors. The only reason they're on this list is because it is home, and you can never count out home. Next, we got the LA Lakers. I believe the only team with the proper cap space to actually make room for LeBron this offseason. The plan for them, and they've already stated this multiple times, is to sign LeBron and another max free agent, whether it be Paul George or DeMarcus Cousins, or maybe even Chris Paul, you know, who knows. As many have said, LeBron does live in LA in the offseason, and what better city to be the league's biggest star in than Los Angeles, playing for the Lakers. Let's just say Paul George is the one that signs there, because that is, in all likelihood, gonna be the guy that signs with the Lakers. A core group of Lonzo, Paul George, LeBron, Ingram, and Kuzma is a very interesting team in the West. But let's just keep it a buck, that's not beating the Warriors. And if LeBron is about beating the Warriors and winning championships, that is simply not enough. And it's not even as good as a team as the 2017 Cavs, if we're being honest. You have a lot of young pieces that still need time to develop, and personally, I don't think they are as poised as the likes of Jason Tatum and Jaylen Brown and Donovan Mitchell. Paul George is a pretty inconsistent player. Coaching was already in question last year. It may be the easiest place to negotiate and sign, but as far as the competitive aspect of it, it's near the very bottom of the list. As a side note, just because the pitch will be very similar to what LA is going to give, the Miami Heat have also been mentioned to be on the list for pretty much the same reasons as LA, minus the young pieces. The 76ers have become to many the favorites to land LeBron. You have a pretty good coach in Brett Brown. You have possible superstars in the making in Joel Embiid and Ben Simmons that are some of the most ready out the gate young players in recent memory. You also have the X factor that is Markelle Fultz, a very underrated player in Dario Saric, a first team all defender in Robert Covington, and the possibility of JJ Redick signing for a heavily discounted price because he already got his money last year. You have a team that has the potential to give Golden State the most mismatch problems of any team in the league, can play switch defense, and protect the paint. Combine that with the fact that they're in the East, I can clearly see why they are the favorites. The big concern with this group is one, health. No one really knows what the hell is going on with Markel, and Joel Embiid's health is still in question. We also don't know how LeBron and Simmons will mesh with Simmons not having a jump shot. I know LeBron can play off ball, but even then, Simmons has to be able to shoot at the very least a mid-range jump shot. And also the upper management. Considering LeBron's history with Dan Gilbert, it may rub him the wrong way that this franchise even has that on their resume, even if Colangelo is already fired. The Warriors have also been listed as candidates, and it's pretty obvious what their attraction is, and that is to stack up them rings. It is also obvious that the con is that the GOAT conversation ends once he joins that team, period, point blank. The Houston Rockets have also been one of the best candidates for LeBron, and you have a team with one of the best coaches in the league in Mike D'Antoni. You have one of the best point guards in the league, a very close friend, and a guy who wants to beat the Warriors just as bad as LeBron and Chris Paul, the soon-to-be reigning MVP and James Harden. You have a team that was one win away from beating the Warriors this year, and that is the biggest attraction for them. The fact that out of all the teams in the hunt, they have shown the most tangible evidence of their ability to beat the Warriors. However, the likelihood of this happening is just so small from a salary perspective. Chris Paul doesn't want anything less than the max. I believe Eric Gordon and Ryan Anderson would have to go as well, and it's gonna be really hard to find trade partners who want those two just to free up cap space. There's also the Clint Capella situation, how they're going to handle that situation. The Rockets would literally have to gut the roster, including key role players, in order to sign LeBron. And by then, if you're LeBron, you begin to wonder about the depth of the team, Chris Paul's injury history, and Harden's performances or lack thereof in the playoffs. And by then, Houston becomes somewhat less of an attractive option. The Celtics have risen in a lot of rumors lately from Chris Haynes and Stephen A. Smith, and I find this to be a very intriguing destination. One, because I'm a Boston fan, you know, and LeBron to Boston, come on. And two, well, there's actually a multitude of reasons. But first, let's start off with the pros. What you have in Boston is the best combination, in my opinion, of winning now and extending your career. You have what many consider the second best coach in the league in Brad Stevens. You have Kyrie Irving, a proven championship caliber star player that has already played with LeBron in the past, has already gone to battles with LeBron, has already gone to the finals with him. You have great two-way young wings in Jaylen Brown and Jason Tatum, who have shown that they are ready to step up in the big moments and will only improve in the future. There are minimal questions with injuries, and they perfectly fit today's style of play. You have a big that rivals the versatility of a Draymond Green and a great veteran in Al Horford. You have a defense that can properly switch on everything, that actually has competent defenders in every single position, except for maybe point guard with Kyrie. Most of the questions that need to be answered, to be honest, are more questions about people's values. Is Danny Ainge willing to trade Hayward after promising him all he promised, and then he gets injured in the first 5 minutes of the season in a freak injury? Is he willing to trade that guy? Does LeBron James want to join a team that's been a rival of his for over a decade now? Does he want to buy into a system, or is he going to want to change the system for his game? And Kyrie Irving, will he be willing to play with LeBron again, or will this want him to be out of Boston? Some suspect that LeBron was the reason he wanted out, and I definitely see that perspective. However, there is the possibility that his problem was simply LeBron's situation. Maybe he just didn't want to be left with LeBron's leftovers and didn't really have problems with playing with LeBron himself. A lot of questions, man, a lot of questions definitely need to be answered, but definitely it's an intriguing option. The Spurs were mentioned as well, and their main attraction is obviously Greg Popovich, a coach that is highly regarded by LeBron. He finally gets to play with that all-time great coach that he's been missing his whole career, and on top of that, he also gets to play with a top 5, arguably top 3 player in the league when healthy, arguably the best defender in the league, and a superstar in Kawhi Leonard. Combine that with a very intelligent group of role players with Danny Green, Rudy Gay, DeJounte Murray, Manu Ginobili, Tony Parker, Patty Mills, and still a very good player in LaMarcus Aldridge, there really isn't much that LeBron can ask for more in a franchise. However, the questions lie again within the future. How many years does Pop have left? That question was a very big factor in CP3 leaning away from the Spurs last year. Also, how will everyone age? This is a squad that has some pretty old players that are still key players in their system. And also, is LeBron willing to buy into the Popovich system? Because trust me, his stats will indeed go down. So there you go. Those are all the options LeBron has in free agency, and definitely all have their pros and their cons. The question now is, where should LeBron go and where will he go? Now, to me, I think the best option for him, and call me biased all you want, but I personally think, objectively speaking, I really do think it is the Boston Celtics. What you have in this team is elite coaching, an elite defense, a system in which LeBron does not have to be relied on for 90% of the offense, a system that, in my opinion, will allow LeBron to easily transition into that off-ball, highly skill-reliant assassin player that we remember Jordan and Kobe for late in their career. They could also run a lineup of Kyrie, Brown, Tatum, LeBron, and Horford. And that, in my opinion, can legitimately go toe-to-toe with the Hampton Five, both offensively and defensively. This is a team with a plethora of shot creators, floor spacers, and are great in fourth quarter execution. He is also still in the East, so he can rack up them finals appearances. And quite frankly, this is a team where he can win 60 plus games, still put up amazing numbers, and legitimately win the MVP. Kyrie is still only 26. Tatum and Brown are too young for me to even Google their age and worry about it. Rozier and Smart are both under 25. Al Horford's game looks like it's going to age very well. And by going to them, you would be in the East, where you would be the clear favorite to come out of it, instead of going to Philly, where there's still a little bit of doubt whether or not you can get past a fully healthy Boston squad. In other words, it would be doing what KD did when joining Golden State to eliminate OKC as a threat. Again, like I stated earlier, a lot of value questions will need to be answered, but it comes down to this. If LeBron and Kyrie can once again coexist, and everyone is cool with accepting a rival by trading away a guy who came here to beat him, but got injured in a gruesome way in the game where they were trying to beat him, from a purely basketball perspective, this is LeBron's best chance of beating Golden State. Now, where will he go? I'm feeling like it's going to be the Lakers for some reason. I really feel like San Antonio is a really good destination for him. To me, they're my second best destination for him. But for some reason, I just feel like it's such a LeBron move to call people and team up in one place where salaries are easy to work with. Is he going to be favored to win a championship in LA? No. But damn, it's coming to a point where I think he's realized that the finals record argument is just over. It's time for the biggest superstar in the game to play in the game's most glamorous team, rack up stats, rack up the records. His whole MVP case of being the most valuable player in the league will still be intact on the Lakers. And the Lakers sound familiar to the Cavs in the sense that they are willing to get LeBron whatever he wants, even if it costs them in the long run. And also, man, how sweet would it be for the Celtics and the Lakers rivalry to renew in a LeBron versus Kyrie matchup? And I think that is something LeBron James really wants to have. But with that being said, let me know where the King will end up next year. And I'm sure I'm going to hear a lot of B-Souls is biased jokes. I haven't heard those in a minute. You know what I'm saying? But hey, that's my objective opinion. Take it or leave it. But just think about it, man. Just think about all the scenarios I just said. Think about what you think is the best option for LeBron. But with that being said, I am out. Peace.